Hello, my name is Tim Raines. I'm a regional leader for security and compliance business acceleration for Europe, the Middle East, and Africa, based in London. Thank you for joining us for the AWS Summit Online. This session is focused on a topic that typically garners a lot of attention outside of the United States, the Clarifying Lawful Overseas Use of Data Act, also known as the Cloud Act. The name of this act tends to generate a lot of confusion about its purpose and scope. In this session, I'll put these things into context and discuss how to manage risks that are often associated with the Cloud Act. To do this, I'll discuss three different topic areas. First, I'll give you an overview of the Cloud Act and how AWS works to protect customer content. Then, we'll put the Cloud Act into a risk management context that will help both public sector and private sector organizations understand and manage associated risks. Finally, I'll discuss how AWS customers can protect data using encryption and key management, two powerful data protection controls among the many security and compliance controls that AWS offers. As you've already heard me mention, the Cloud Act actually stands for the Clarifying Lawful Overseas Use of Data Act. It's important to start with the title because it tells you a little bit about what the law does and who it applies to. Let's start by discussing the basics and what the Cloud Act does. The Cloud Act states that companies subject to U.S. jurisdiction can be required to produce data under their control, regardless of where it's held. One of the most common misunderstandings about the Cloud Act is that it's applicable to only U.S. companies. This is not true. The Cloud Act applies to a number of providers that are subject to U.S. jurisdiction, including email providers, telecom companies, social media sites, and cloud providers, whether they are established in the United States or in another country. This means any foreign company with an office or subsidiary in the United States is subject to U.S. jurisdiction. U.S. courts have ruled that even non-U.S. websites that have been used by customers based in the United States have been subject to U.S. jurisdiction and therefore could be subject to the Cloud Act. Another common misunderstanding about the Cloud Act is that it somehow provides the U.S. government with unfettered access to data. This is simply false. The Cloud Act does not grant law enforcement agencies free access to data stored in the cloud. Law enforcement can compel service providers to provide data only by meeting the rigorous legal standards for a warrant issued by a U.S. court. U.S. law sets a high bar for obtaining a warrant, requiring review by an independent judge, a direct relationship between the information requested and the crime, and that the request is clear, accurate, and proportional. This is the opposite of unfettered access. When AWS receives a request for data located outside of the United States, we have the right to challenge it and a long track record of doing so. Each request from law enforcement is reviewed by a team of legal professionals. As part of that review, they assess whether the request would violate the laws of the United States or a foreign country, or would violate the customer's rights. Amazon rigorously enforces applicable legal standards to limit or reject outright any law enforcement request for data coming from any country, including the United States. We actively push back on law enforcement agencies to address concerns, which frequently results in them withdrawing their request. In the event we cannot resolve a dispute, we do not hesitate to go to court. Amazon has a history of formally challenging government requests for customer information that we believe are overbroad or otherwise inappropriate. We will continue to resist requests, including those that conflict with local laws such as GDPR in the European Union, to do everything we can to protect customer data. We will also continue to notify customers before disclosing content, and we will provide advanced encryption and key management services that customers can use to protect their data further. We have industry-leading encryption services that give our customers a range of options to encrypt data in transit and at rest and to manage encryption and decryption keys because encrypted content is rendered useless without the applicable decryption keys. I'll discuss this in detail in the data protection section of this session. AWS is vigilant about its customers' privacy and security. We are committed to providing all customers, including governmental agencies, who trust us with their most sensitive content, with the most extensive set of security services and features to help ensure complete control of their data. The Cloud Act did not alter or weaken this commitment. On the contrary, the Cloud Act recognizes the right of cloud providers to challenge requests that conflict with another country's laws or national interests, and requires that governments respect local rules of law. Additionally, foreign governments concerned about the risk of government data disclosure may be entitled to sovereign immunity. The United States recognizes that under the principle of sovereign immunity, foreign governments have effective legal means under U.S. law to prevent disclosure of their data. You can get more detail on the Cloud Act and what it means from this blog post on the AWS Security blog. Additionally, you can watch one of the attorneys that manages law enforcement requests for AWS speak about this process in detail in this video recorded with me at the most recent AWS Public Sector Summit in Washington, D.C. Now let's shift gears and talk about how to put the Cloud Act into a risk management aspect that will help public sector and private sector organizations understand and manage risks associated with it. There are different ways to calculate risk. Some of the organizations I've talked to perform a quantitative analysis where they use mathematical calculations to work out a risk score for each threat to their organization. Other organizations I've talked to perform more of a qualitative analysis, which is less focused on math and more focused on qualitative measures and characteristics that are meaningful to their organization. And some organizations will use a combination of quantitative and qualitative approaches. But in its simplest form, risk is the combination of probability and impact. The probability that a threat will be realized and the impact to the organization if it is realized. Many of the organizations that I talked to in EMEA use this approach to estimate the incremental risk of U.S. government access to data when they contemplate adding AWS to their current on-premises IT estate. Let's look at how some of them do this. In order to estimate the incremental risk, they need to estimate both the impact and the probability sides of the equation. Very often, they already know what the impact is because their legal team has processed warrants, subpoenas, or other court orders in the past. And frankly, receiving a court order isn't the risk they worry about. They worry that a vendor and their supply chain will receive a court order for data in their possession and they won't know about it. So in most cases, the public sector and private sector organizations that I talk to already understand the impact side of the risk equation. But AWS can still help them with the probability side of the risk equation. We do this by publishing the Amazon Information Request Reports. These reports provide the volume of warrants, subpoenas, and court orders that AWS receives, typically in 6-month increments. To calculate the probability of an AWS customer receiving one of these requests, let's add the number of them together. In the example I'm showing you here, for the second half of 2019, let's add 192, 19, 31, and 249 to get the total number of possible requests from law enforcement in the United States. In this case, the total is 491. Now let's divide the total by the total number of AWS customers. I don't have an exact number of customers to share with you, so let's use a low number, which will calculate a higher probability than is likely. Just to be conservative, let's use 2 million customers as our denominator. 491 divided by 2 million multiplied by 100 gives us a probability of 0.025%. This means the probability of U.S. government access to data for AWS customers during this time period was a fraction of 1%. You can repeat this exercise for other time periods using the data provided in the Amazon Information Request Report. The probability is typically a fraction of 1%. Because most organizations have limited resources, they have to prioritize. Once they've combine the impact and the probability estimates to create a risk score, Then they stack rank the risk of government access to data with all the other risks that they already manage for their organization. Risks like economic risks, financial risks, HR risks, legal risks, cybersecurity risks, and others. Because of the relatively low probability, many of the customers I talk to decide not to spend resources and budget to mitigate the risk of government access to data. They have other higher priority risks that they have to actively manage. However, there are some organizations that still want to mitigate this risk. This is where the rich set of security and compliance services and features that AWS offers to its customers can help. Let's look at a couple of these capabilities now. The model we are working towards is ubiquitous encryption, where customer data is always protected in transit and at rest using encryption. Access to data is restricted using identity and access management, and all operations are auditable through API log entries in AWS CloudTrail. Let's look at this in more detail, focusing on protecting data at rest using AES 256-bit encryption and a range of key management options customers have. Client-side encryption is where you encrypt your data before you put it into the cloud. You have many, many options to perform client-side encryption. Let's look at some. In this scenario, this is your on-premises data center with an application processing data in it. We're going to encrypt the data on-premises before putting it into the cloud. Our on-premises encryption application gets an encryption key from the on-premises key management infrastructure. Once the data is encrypted, it is uploaded into a cloud service that accepts data. The unencrypted data and the keys are never shared with AWS. Another option is to move the encryption application into the EC2 service in the cloud to get all the cost, agility, and scalability benefits that the cloud offers. The encryption process works the same way as the application gets the encryption key from on-premises key management infrastructure. Again, unencrypted data and the keys were never shared with AWS. Another option is to put the key management infrastructure into the cloud as well. Customers can manage this themselves or have a trusted third party like an AWS technology partner do it for them. Yet more options, use an AWS key management service that is integrated into the cloud, like AWS KMS or AWS Cloud HSM. In the case of KMS, you can even import key material from on-premises key management infrastructures that export key material. These services make key management much easier and are generally much more cost-effective than on-premises solutions. Now, let me show you an example of client-side encryption in action. In this example, the customer has built an application that performs encryption using Amazon S3 encryption client. The application runs in the customer's on-premises data center. The application encrypts the data using a data key. It then gets a master key from the on-premises key management infrastructure to encrypt the data key. The application sends the encrypted data and the encrypted data key to the Amazon Simple Storage service. Excuse me. Because the data and the data key are both encrypted, no one can access these without the proper decryption key, which is kept on-premises. To decrypt the data, the process is reversed. The encrypted data and encrypted data key are downloaded from Amazon S3 to the application running in the on-premises data center. The application finds the correct master key in the on-premises key management infrastructure and decrypts the data key. The application then uses the data key to decrypt the data. If you're interested in learning more about client-side encryption and other encryption and key management options, please check out this webinar that I recorded. And while you're at it, please check out the areas where all security teams should spend some time. The top 10 list in this blog post will help them avoid stubbing their toes. And finally, I'll leave you with some resources on the Cloud Act that can help you further understand what it is and what it isn't. And please remember, AWS is committed to providing our customers with industry-leading privacy and security protections when using our products and services, including providing our customers the most extensive set of security services and encryption to help ensure complete customer control of their data. The Cloud Act does not alter this commitment. Thank you for attending this session, and please share your feedback by completing the session evaluation.